First, I would like to thank you all for spending your time joining our breakfast seminar this morning. And I hope you had a good weekend last week, especially for those who celebrated the Chinese New Year. Okay, we are now in the year of rooster. Okay, so today we will talk about buying and selling property in Cambodia. Before we go into this, let me briefly introduce about our firm first. So about our firm, Scarry Associates. So our firm is one of the Southeast Asia leading legal and investment advisory firm, and we have been providing a skill, counsel and knowledge about business insight for over 2 decades. We based in Cambodia, and we have offices in Laos, Myanmar, and our experienced team of advisors bring considerable general and sector-specific expertise to the challenges confronting companies doing business in the emerging market. We are proud that our clients comprise many of the world's premier companies, banks, financial institutions, governments, and global development organizations. About our real estate and construction practice group. Our real estate and construction practice group provide advice on all aspects of conveyance, including drafting of purchase and sale agreements, due diligence, long-term lease registration, hypotheque registration, construction permit, title conversion, property transfer, property consolidation, economic land concession, and real estate license. Our firm also completes title searches and coordinates the filing of legal documents for all types of real estate transactions in Cambodia. And about my background. I get my master's degree in law from in Asian Law, Global Business and Sustainable International Development from University of Washington in Seattle, United States. Before joining the firm, I was associated with several legal entities in Cambodia and in the US. I think better that I maybe talk loudly to speak. Okay, so I work before joining the firm. I work at the Khmer Tribunal as intern. Okay, Royal Team of Law and Economics, the first Cambodian team to join the LMC with Mood International in Austria.
I think maybe try to speak loudly better. Yeah. Okay. That's better. So I will speak loud during my presentation better. So okay, so that continue. So yeah, and also I work at Asian Counseling and Referral Service, a non-profit organization based in Seattle. It's a large non-profit organization there. And okay, this is the agenda for our today. So we will talk about seven subtopics on the properties. Then we will have a Q&A session. So our first topic is about property tenure and ownership. Two, short title and hard title. Three, property acquisition by foreigners. Four, protection of interest in property. Five, condo law. Six, sale and purchase process. Seven, level taxes. Then we will have the Q&A session. So we will spend around 45 minutes for the first seven topics. And then we will reserve around 15 minutes for our Q&A session. So during my presentation, if you have any questions, so please keep it for the Q&A session. That is better for us to manage the time. Okay, so this topic, I took it myself from the top of my house in the Tutupung area, Russian market. So this picture, why I took this bring this picture to you. This picture can tell us how the property market is doing in Cambodia now. especially in Phnom Penh. It's really booming now. You can see the tall building is under construction everywhere in town. Okay, our first topic about property tenure and ownership. So Cambodia have not keep the freehold system of land tenure under the 2001 land law. At present, there are three main types of land tenure exists. First one is about the freehold. So what is freehold? Freehold is about the ownership. So you can do whatever as the owner can do under the Cambodian law. Okay, freehold, you can do anything you want to do as the owner. To the leasehold. So under Cambodian law, we have two types of leases. One is short-term lease and the other one is the long-term lease. So for long-term lease, it is 15 years or more. And then you can register with the land department for the long-term lease. And then have your name or the title as a tenant. Three concessions. Concession is conditional leases granted by the government over the state private land. But a few years ago, the concession has been stopped by the government because the land issue that happening in Cambodia several years ago. Okay, now we go to the soft title and hard title. So what is soft title and what is hard title? So these two terms are widely used in Cambodia to refer to the right to an immovable property. But actually, these two terms not really can be found in the legal document, the common term that we use to refer to a right. So what is hard title? Hard title is the title that is issued and recognized by the Ministry of Land Management, Urban Planning and Construction. So it is registered at the national level. Thus, it is the strongest form of the property ownership because it is registered at the national level. Everything is properly measured and issued. We are the soft title. Soft title is only issued by the local authorities. For example, the chief of the village, chief of the commune, Songkat, Khan, something like that. It is not registered at the national level. Thus, this makes the title less secure comparing to the hard title. Because soft title is only issued by the local authority, it's not at the national level. So there are some risk associated with this title. First one, there might be a conflicting claims to the title since it is not confirmed and recorded at the national level registry, because it's only with the local level. The common problem is overlapping boundary. Why? Because the title is not properly measured by the land department, so sometimes there are a lot of issues with the boundary among the neighbors. Always happen, okay? Because it's not properly measured by the land department. So maybe the chief of the village just go there and then tell you to do the measurement, but it's not properly conducted, something like that. So it always happens with the boundary issue. Three, duplicate of soft title documents issued to different applicants or sometimes to the same owner. Why? Because at the local authority level, there's no system or database to keep the record of the title or the who are the owner. So sometimes when one applicant go to the chief of the league, request for the title, then the chief of the league may issue the title to him or her. And this can issue to a different people or the same owner can go there and request the same title, maybe giving the reason that have lost the title or something like that, and then get more duplicate title. This is a real case. I have an auntie in Siem Reap, and she runs a small microfinance company, and then she told me that one of her clients has used 5 different soft titles to borrow money from 5 different microfinance institutions. Because the guy is good, he has good relation with the chief of the building. He always go there and talk with the chief of the building and then ask for a new title, claiming that oh blah blah blah, something like that. Then he used that title to borrow money from different companies. Then now we found out, now already put into the court proceeding. Okay. But it's not good for everyone involved in this case.
Hard title.
So hard title refer to three type of property title certificate. The first one is certificate of land use and occupation rights, and we commonly call this a chicken feather title. Why we call it chicken feather title? Because I will show you on the title. This is a chicken feather. The picture of chicken feather over there. I will show you. Okay. And this title was issued to the owner before the land law was adopted. Way before the land law, long time ago, during the state of Cambodia, something like that. Before the land law of the kingdom, the second kingdom of Cambodia. Next, certificate of immovable property possessions. So this title, we get this title through the sporadic land registration. What is sporadic land registration? The sporadic land registration is a land registration that is initiated by the individual owner in the area that the systematic land registration has not been conducted by the government. Okay, so we get, so when the title is issued through the sporadic land registration, then the title is called the certificate of movable property possession. Next, the certificate of movable property ownership, systematic land registration. So we get this title through the systematic land registration. What is systematic land registration? Systematic land registration is the land registration that is initiated and conducted by the government on the whole specific area. You may have heard about the government send the student to do the land survey, so that's also the process to do the systematic land registration. So the title getting from that process called the certificate of movable property ownership. Actually, I should put one more thing about the strata title. The strata title is also the hard title. So what is strata title? About the title to prove your ownership over the condo, the apartment. Then we will discuss that in our next slide. Okay, about soft title. Soft title refer to very formal title other than the hard title in general. Okay, it can be the application for land occupation, maybe the possessor of the land. Okay, submit a request form to the chief of the building of the commune. Request the chief, okay, to issue or to recognize his right over the land. Okay, that's also the consider after some time. Letter of transfer acknowledged by local authority. So the like a set of purchase agreement between the buyer and the seller, and then have it recognized and acknowledged by the local, the chief of the commune or something like that. Okay, also the subtitle. Simple and sometimes it can be a simple and private sale purchase agreement. It's a simple sale purchase agreement between the buyer and the seller. Okay? Maybe you do not have the certification from the local authority. That's also considered as the soft title. Okay, this is a sample of hard title. Is a certain certificate of removable property ownership. The ownership, okay. You have mentioned that before, right? Ownership, possession, okay, use right, and while the strata title, what the hard title. So this one is the certificate of removable property ownership. So how we can distinguish from the other title. There's a map here, a map to show the location of the land. Okay. So this is the title, also the title of the title. Okay. I'll show the title, the immovable property ownership. Okay, this one is the certificate of immovable property possession. This one we get it from the sporadic land registration, right? The previous one we get it from the systematic land registration, that's why we call the ownership. This one is about the possession. So there's no map in here, right? It's also a hard title, issued by the land department. But we get it through the sporadic land registration. I think we missed one. This one here. Oh, maybe, okay, here. Sorry, the first one, not clear, okay. So this one, what is this one? This one is the first title that I mentioned about the land use right, the chicken feather title. Wait, can you find a chicken feather in here? Yeah, here. Okay, chicken feather. That's why we commonly call it title and chicken feather title. Okay, so this one is issued, okay, during the state of Cambodia. Around 1980 something, okay? So a long time ago before the land law was adopted. Okay. Then this one is the ownership. This one the possession. Okay, this one the strata title. Okay, the strata title is the title on the condo or apartment. Okay. It also the hard title, this is the plan, okay, the floor. The floor plan. Okay, then tell the name of the building. Okay, tell you which floor are you in, and then the size of your unit.
How do you know if any of this is real? I mean, how can you tell it's a legitimate certificate from the ministry?
We can do so by do the due diligence. We can do the type of search. Okay, map because at the ministry they have the record. Okay, let me get the cross check for us. This is the page of the hard title. So the name of the owner, okay, the size of the property. And then the history of the transfer. Okay, transfer from who is the first owner, okay, transfer to who, blah blah blah. Okay, the history. This is the short title. It's a simple, okay, transfer letter. And then you have the recognition by the local authority, the head, the chief of the Songkat, something like skin smile. And this is in English, the same form, okay, very simple certification from the chief of the Songkat or Khan. Okay, now we go to number three, property acquisition by foreigners. Property land ownership in Cambodia is restricted to Cambodian citizens only. So how can a foreigner acquire property in Cambodia? There are certain ways that a foreigner can acquire property in Cambodia. First one about A, the Khmer nominee. Khmer nominee is when the foreign national asks the Cambodian national to be he or her nominee, and then have the title register underneath the other Khmer nominee. Okay? Like ask someone to title on your behalf and then you take the money. B, Cambodian land holding company. Under Cambodian law, the company of Khmer national when the share is owned by a Cambodian national more than 51%. So that's the company of Cambodian national. Then with that status, the company can own the land in Cambodia. So in order to get that, then we have to have like 51% share, okay, held by the Cambodian national, and then the foreign investor own 49% of the share. The strata title. Strata title Foreigner may acquire title to the qualifying condo subject to certain conditions. So the title for the condo apartment. We will discuss this more in our next slide of the condo law. Okay. Short or long term lease. There's no restriction. Okay. On the foreigner to take the lease. Okay. Over private or state private land. There's no restriction. Foreigner can take short or long term lease. In the case of long term lease, then you can register the land department. Okay. Land concession. Up until the moratorium, between the time that the government stopped giving the land concession, foreigner have been permitted to take concession of state private land. So foreigner can get the land concession. Next, citizenship. It is possible for a foreigner to acquire Cambodian national in Cambodia. So with this status, then you can own property in Cambodia. Okay, now we go to talk about protection of interest in property. There is a number of ways that you can protect, especially for the foreign investor, to protect the interest in buying a property in Cambodia. We'll talk about the nominee structure. The first one about in the case of property owned in the name of Khmer nominee. So in this case about the individual Khmer nominee. Individual Khmer nominee. We generally advise our client to undertake these steps, okay, to protect their interest when they use an individual to buy the property in Cambodia. First one, enter into a nominee agreement with the Khmer nominee. You enter into this agreement, okay? Set out the arrangement, the relation between the foreign buyer and the Khmer nominee, okay? Then you require the Khmer nominee grant a long-term lease to the foreigner. When you do the long-term lease, then you can register the long-term lease with the land department. Then you have, then your name will be on the title of the tenant. You can, so for the long-term lease under Cambodian law, you can do 50 years plus 50 years. Okay. Then take a mortgage under Cambodian law, we call it hypotec. Fancy framework, I think. And register the same on the title. Then you can do the hypotec, the mortgage, and then register, and then your name can be on the title after. And then you hold the original title of this because you are the real buyer, the one who paid the money. You can just keep the original title, okay? Don't give the original title to the Khmer nominee because sometimes the Khmer nominee they do something with the title. They just keep it with you. Right? Require the nominee prepare a will, okay? Because if you can just pass away, something like that, then you have a will, okay? And then the will again, let's say you are the beneficiary of the property, something like that. Sign arrangement with the family members, applicable of matrimonial property, okay? The marital agreement between the husband and wife saying that this property is only for the foreign investor only, okay? In the case that pass away, something like that. Okay? Now, in the case of a property owned by a landholding company, so in this case about the land owned by the landholding company, okay, it's quite similar to the previous case, the land owned by the individual man company, okay. Similar, enter into a nominee protection document, setting out the arrangement and the relation among the shareholders, the national, the foreigner and the national. Require the landholding company to get a long-term lease to the foreigner, similar. You ask the landholding company to get a long-term lease and you register with the land department. Take a mortgage and then register the same on the title, same. Hold the original title of this. Require the nominee prepare a will, sign an agreement with family members to buy a matrimonial property contract. Okay. Quite similar to the individual nominee structure. See, in the case of long-term lease, we recommend that the foreign tenant register the lease on the title. Yeah, I mentioned that.
I mentioned this in our previous in my previous discussion. So in the case of long-term lease, then you go to the land department and then register your long-term lease, and you have your title on the list, and also you will get the certificate of long-term lease, the long-term lease certificate, okay, as the new certificate for you, the tenant. So you will have to certificate in this case. So one is the certificate of mobile property ownership, okay, like the land title, and then the other one is the certificate of long-term lease, that the long certificate of long-term lease, and the tenant can take it. And then in the certificate of ownership, then your name are also mentioned in there.
Okay, now we talk about the condo law. So it's commonly called just the condominium law, but the actual name called Law on Providing Foreigners with Ownership Rights in Private Units of Co-owned Buildings. This is the actual name of the law. And it was promulgated back on 24th May 2010. Yeah, so it's been 7 years already, yeah, 7 years already. After the promulgation of this law, then you can feel that there are a lot of development going on in the town. Because this law allows the foreigner to own the private unit, okay? To own private unit on certain qualified condo, okay? Provided that. Okay, A, the building has strata title, okay? Only, so it has to be a co-owned building, and the building has a strata title, okay? B, the condo is located above the ground floor, meaning that your unit has to be from the first floor up, okay? You cannot own the ground floor unit, okay? Because it, contrary to the land law that only Cambodian national can own the land, okay, the ground floor is also the law considered part, okay, they are close to the land, okay. And then the foreign ownership of the building does not exceed 70% of the private of the living area, okay. So if the whole building only 70% of the living area that can be sold to the foreigner, okay? Not more than that. D, there is a property management agreement in place among the co-owners. So generally, for the big apartment, they have the internal agreement, the management agreement among the owner or the private community, okay? So you have to meet the four requirements, okay, in order for a building to sell out the unit to the foreigner. And this is predominantly newly constructed apartment building that has strata title. So only the new, mostly about the new building in town and under development, okay, because the new building that has the co-owned building that has to get the status from the land department, a co-owned building, okay? But it is possible to convert an old building to a co-owned building. It is possible, but it is difficult because the old building, you do not have the land title. Law flat do not have the land title for the whole area. So the people just build and then have their soft title on each unit, okay? If you want to convert that old building out of co-owned building, then maybe try to meet this 45, maybe try to get a land title for the whole area, okay, and then you get to have the management agreement, and then you need to, okay, divide the floor, and then something like that. And you can do so, but so far I have not seen that happen. Okay, it's really hard to convert the old building to the co-owned building. Our next topic about sale purchase process. This is a brief summary of the sand purchase process. So before you want to buy a property, first you need to identify your property. After you identify your property, you know where you want to buy your property. Then you can do the initial due diligence. Initial due diligence, like you do the title search, okay, to check whether there's any boundary issue, any claim against this property, something like that. Okay, the initial due diligence, whether the who is the real owner, whether the size of the land is accurately a measure. Then when you are happy with the title, then you negotiate the term with the owner. You negotiate the commercial terms with the owner. When you done the commercial the negotiation or the commercial terms with the owner, then you can enter into the sale purchase agreement, your private sale purchase agreement. Then when you done with the sale purchase agreement, then you can schedule an appointment with the land officer. Okay, submit the relevant document, and then sign the official transfer document in front of the land official. Yep. The document generally we call the a friend that one document, something like that. Okay, with the official land transfer document, you need to sign that in front of the land officer, and then you will pay the stamp duty. Sign that and you proceed the tax payment. After you pay the stamp duty, then all the document will be brought back to the land department, and then process for the title transfer. Then you will get a new title with the name of the buyer on it. So when you get the title, then the last step you can do a confirmatory due diligence, like to confirm that the title is properly transferred. Okay, to check that the name or the name is spelled correctly. I have one case where the land officer assists with the land transfer, and then the land officer mistakenly spelled the name of the buyer. That is a problem, right? Because your name is wrong in the title, then how can you show the title to your potential buyer, because you are not really the real owner. If you look at the name, okay, then you need to do that again, and it also costs you and also time consuming. So that's why you need to check that to make sure that everything is completely properly completed. Okay, our last topic about relevant. First one, all property transfer in Cambodia is subject to 4% stamp duty tax. Okay, 4% stamp duty tax. Stamp duty tax on all property transfer. And this now applicable to both hard title and soft title. Before only hard title is subject to 4% stamp duty tax. But last year, the government has introduced a new declaration. Let's say both and hard title are subject to this 4% stamp duty. Before, the investor or some people, they prefer to buy the soft title because they do not need to pay the stamp duty, 4% by money. And note that this 4% is the 4% of the value assessed by the tax department. Okay? It's not the 4% of the contract price on your sale purchase agreement. Okay, 4% of the value assessed by the government. So when you are complete with the signing in front of the land officer, then you bring those documents to the tax department, and the tax department will do the calculation for you. Okay, to assess how much that you will need to pay for the stamp duty. Then we will get that figure and pay with the bank, something like that.
So it's 4% of the value assessed by the tax department. I have a client. So she's living in Australia. So she just buy a property in Cambodia through a command only. Okay. So buy the property, then she just take the only title of it to Australia. Then when she want to sell her property, she just ask a broker, but it's not a professional. They can tell you it's not professional. Then have with the sell of the property, and then the broker, okay, charge her 4% of the contract price. So it cost a lot to her. And then when she came to talk to me, okay, I advise her on that. So she was so upset about that. So it's better to know about it. Okay, 4% of the contract price and 4% of the value assessed by the government is much different. Generally, the value assessed by the tax department is much cheaper than the contract price. It can be 3 or 4 times cheaper. So you can see the value, how much cheaper. Okay. And also note that this stamp duty is not applicable to transfer among some family members. This is also a new regulation. So, for example, between the grandparent and the grandchildren, this 4% stamp duty is not applicable. Okay, they don't, you don't need to pay the 4% stamp duty. Only among some family members. Okay, the government just want to cut the burden, okay, to the citizen. Okay, if a property is sold by a real regime taxpayer, we generally mean the company, right? Real regime taxpayer, the company. Then the gain will form part of the taxable profit. So it's part of your profit. Then under Cambodia, the profit is subject to 20% tax. Okay, 20% on profit. So the loss. 10% withholding tax is applicable to lease of property. So all the leases need to pay the 10% withholding tax. But in real practice, I can tell you, it's only applicable to when a party to a lease is a company. Because the company need to do what to file the money tax, something like that, you need to include that in your on your in your filing. Generally, between the private, between the individual leases, like the Cambodian national lessor and Cambodian national lessee or the foreign lessee, also this 10% double tax not really happen, because under Cambodian law there is no individual tax, so the person does not just go to the tax department to do the filing, just keep it. Okay? But by law it should be 10% subject to all leases. But in practice only in the case that one party is a company. Net arrears of net annual property tax. Arrears means the unpaid annual property tax. So if you owe the annual property tax a few years ago, then you want to transfer your property to your buyer, cannot be completed because you owe the money to the government, then you need to pay out the amount first in order for the land department to transfer the property for you. Because the land department and the tax department, they have the record, so they can check whether this property is paid or not yet paid the property tax. And then the last one, this is the formula on how to calculate your annual property tax. So your annual property tax in Cambodia, is equal to the total property value plus 80%, and then minus 100 million riel, then multiply by 0.1%. So the total property value here, then you get this value from the tax department. Because the tax department will have to assess your value, okay? And in Cambodia, in big cities, the tax department has a list that can tell you which area costs how much, something like that. So when you bring your title to the tax department, to the tax brand where your property is located, then the tax department will assess for you how much your property is worth based on the lift. Means the lift of the tech department, okay? Then multiply by 80%. Then you will see the amount that you need to pay for your energy property tax. Okay. Okay, this is the end for my presentation. Thank you so much for your attention. And if you have any question, please ask.
Hi, yeah, I've got a couple of questions.
Okay.
If I've got soft title in the province, like Kandal, can I change it to hard title? That's my first question. Second question is, when did the 4% tax on soft title start?
Okay, so you have two questions, right? Okay, so answering to the first question, yes, you can convert your soft title in Ghana. So all the soft title can be converted to hard title through what? Through the sporadic land registration. You do not want to wait for the government to go to your area. Okay, if you do not want to wait for the government to go to your area to do the systematic land registration, then you can initiate by yourself, go to the land department, okay, do the sporadic land registration, and you will get a hard title for the certificate of removal property possession.
And how much does that cost?
It from our experience, it depends on the size and the location of your property, and the land officer, okay, will inform you about that.
So is there a set price? Is there a fixed price?
A fixed price, no.
Yeah. And the
tax? Oh, the second question, sorry. Yeah. Second question. About the foreign stamp duty. So the foreign stamp duty is applicable to the soft title, I remember that last year. It's very recently. Yeah, and then I think last month, I mean like that, the Prime Minister had issued like a sub-decree or regulation to regulate, like before, let's say June last year, the 4% stamp duty applicable to soft title. But what happened before June? Because there are so many transfers, right? So then what happened to those transfers, okay? Then the government say that only starting from a certain point of time that the 4% stamp duty applicable. So the previous transfer is not subject to the 4% stamp duty. So the Minister of Economy and Finance can issue a new regulation to clarify that. Because a lot of people are really concerned because they have bought the land through a soft title, but the soft title has been transferred with so many people. So they concerned that they are the one who needs to pay all the transfer. It's a really big amount. So the government has issued a regulation to clarify that. Okay, thank you for your question.
So, by the law for the 4% duty stamp tax, who will be paid, the seller or the buyer?
That's a good question. So, under the law, actually, the buyer is subject to the 4% stamp duty. Why? Because the government considers that the seller, okay, maybe they get value, so out of way, then the car cannot approach to the owner. So only approach to the buyer, then the buyer can have a new title. But in the practice, it can only the owner pay the 4% stamp duty. That's practice. I think more than 90%. Yes, the seller, the owner, cover the 4% stamp duty. But by law, actually, the buyer, because buyer is the one that the company, okay, also. So the seller may run away, or may move to somewhere else. Okay, in fact, the cat on my client who lives in Australia, so the government goes to Australia to grab her to take the same way. But generally, practice the seller, the owner.
You mentioned two, how many chargers?
Yes. Yeah, so this topic is debatable, but
Under Cambodian law, it is said that only Cambodian national can own the land, right? There's no specific provision recognizing that the snow structure is illegal. That's why you can use this, the loophole, okay, to structure this arrangement. But I think a lot of people are concerned about this structure because I think in Thailand, a long time ago, the law is not clear in Cambodia. And then the law is actually happening everywhere. Then, several years ago, then the Thai government issued a new request specifically say that the law structure is illegal. But in Cambodia, you don't have the law regulation. Just say that Cambodian national only that own the land. But the law structure is not really the name of the foreign investor on the Thai court. Actually, it's still the Cambodian national. So, yeah, we do that with the loophole.
But
the
Secretary
said that the law
is not
ready to call the land Thai law on the Thai we have consulted with our team and then we discussed that it's still not possibly clear to produce the arrangement. And yeah, we can discuss this more if you want to discuss this point. Okay. But we have discussed our team and we agree that still have something we can do with this structure.
I think we can add that normally we would, in most cases, recommend to use a landholding structure, a landholding company structure. And then, Sophia, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think it addresses nominees for shareholding, right?
No.
So that provides, depending on how that would be interpreted, if you're concerned about the nominee, then certainly the landholding company provides a number of additional protections for the investor, and you also can avoid the question that Sophia just raised by using the nominees to the shares rather than directly to the land.
So we can
go to
the landholding structure. Actually, depending on the individual nominee, actually we have used to have a case with the court with the individual nominee, and then
Okay.
can do the like something like that. If you can go, you can release right. So we can just release right, right? So the borrower can only have the release right over the property. Then he or she uses the release right with the bank. So we need that the bank has the possibility to write over the release right. Then give the before then maybe you can okay lease the property to another person on that, yeah. Okay? But it's still need to see the whole document. Related document provided that the printer can do with the title. Here is the agreement with the okay owner. Maybe you can do some but maybe you need to get a certain owner, right? So the whatever you have the list, the private form the list. Cannot go beyond that. I need to check the whole document.
Sorry?
You mean renewal and after 50
yes,
or 60 years?
Yes, 50 or just
1 time,
50 years.
Under condition, just say 50 years for 50 years. But that can be, the party can agree to that after the first amendment, they can do that. The second amendment, something like that. So the law not say that you cannot do the second amendment. Let's say 50 years or 50 years. So you can do so as the option of the party.
So in normal properties, do you have auto renewals or do you have?
And what's the
in normal properties, do you have auto renewals or do you just want to renew?
It depends on the agreement of the party. Generally, the people just say 50 years and then have whoever has option to renew for another 50 years. If you want to know multiple, it's okay. See it, because the law does not wait it as a 50 year or 50 years, then it leads to the parties involved. Any other questions?
This is called Roman law on the point of the C. On the C, foreign ownership of the buildings does not exceed 70%. Who will determine this? What happens if a developer sold 90% of the condo to a foreigner? What is the repercussion?
Because when the developer wants to sell the unit to the investor, because each unit has a start time for, right? When the developer wants to sell the unit to the foreigner, then the developer needs to go to the next arm, okay? To the property transfer, sorry. To do the title transfer, okay? Then there, the land department, we check. Let's see how many percent has been owned by the foreigner, how many percent owned by the Cambodian national. So every person needs to go to the land company. And then the land company has the database for each development. Okay.
So therefore the land management may reject the transfer.
That's correct.
If they say
that more than 20% only so it you need to have the title. Then the land company can try to get them.
So what happens if it is during the sale and construction between the condominium is under construction? So the developers just start to sell their property and then they did not submit also another title yet. So once they sell all of their unit, they just submit for the title. And at that time, they just realized that they said, oh, it was to the product. So what happened?
So that the light bulb is on the developer, right? Because actually, by law, you can sell to the unit to the buyer, then you try to develop the unit for a certain percentage, something like that. Then in order for you to apply for the startup title. So in that case, you sell the 20% and you apply to the land partner, the partner will have nothing on that. They say, okay, I will go over your limit and do something differently. Okay, any other questions? Then we do not have. I think we finish early. We start early, okay? And if you have any questions, you can agree, okay, complain. Then you have another part of the question, and you can feel free to ask any questions, you email or call. Thank you so much for your attention.